According to ancient Sumerian legend, a race of technologically advanced extraterrestrials colonized Earth some 6,000 years ago and helped establish sophisticated civilizations in Mesopotamia. The great empires of Sumer, Babylon, Assyria, and even Egypt were the direct result of this interaction with the Anunnaki, the gods who came down from the skies. This ancient alien's account has been popularized by the scholarly research of Zechariah Sitchin in his book, The Twelfth Planet. However, noted Celtic researcher Michael Tessarian suggests that although Sitchin's translations from Sumerian cuneiform are accurate, he speculates that the Sumerians themselves may have deliberately altered this story. His alternative view suggests that a great galactic war may have forced the Anunnaki to seek refuge on our little planet many thousands of years earlier than the Sumerian account implies. And as well, Tessarian claims that the great mythological empires of Atlantis and Lemuria were actually the original Anunnaki colonies. It is believed that these space invaders possessed amazing supernatural technologies described as genetic engineering, mind control, weather manipulation, interstellar spaceflight, nuclear weapons, and even the capacity to destroy celestial bodies. In other words, technologies at least comparable to what modern civilization has virtually duplicated here in the early years of the 21st century. Tessarian's account describes the Anunnaki as a highly aggressive reptilian humanoid race that genetically engineered a slave race out of the indigenous humanoid creatures of Earth. These hybrids became known as the Elohim. However, possessing the high intelligence from their portion of Anunnaki DNA, these Elohim eventually rejected their slave status and established an independent culture of their own in an uneasy truce. But eventually a conflict erupted between these cultures that escalated into a devastating thermonuclear war that laid virtually the entire planet to waste. The epic poem of Vedic antiquity, called the Mahabharata, describes these wars telling of deadly Brahma weapons that decimated whole armies with a flash of fire as bright as a thousand suns, leaving survivors to die days later of a horrible sickness, an uncanny likeness to the effects of modern atomic radiation poisoning. The myth of the lost continent of Atlantis is but a fragmentary description of this great war. According to Greek philosopher Plato's account, in a single day and night of misfortune, the island of Atlantis disappeared into the depths of the sea. A civilization possessing weapons of mass destruction at least equal to or even surpassing technologies we know today was utterly destroyed. The long march of human history, recorded since that mighty catastrophe, marks the slow restoration of those long-lost alien sciences. Dr. Joseph P. Farrell, author of The Cosmic War, states, "There was once a very high paleo-ancient civilization long ago with science and technology far beyond our own. That civilization was interplanetary by extent. It existed in our own celestial neighborhood, it fought a war and blew itself apart, and as it was doing so, realizing that it would lose all of its high science, it initiated efforts to preserve it. The rise of the mystery schools, ancient religions, occult societies, and all such groups since then have been a long-term recovery process, and the people involved have been doing so covertly. Recorded history, starting with the rise of sophisticated civilizations in Mesopotamia some 6,000 years ago, marks the beginning of the Anunnaki return to power, and the epic process of restoring the full extent of their magical sciences. To accomplish this goal, These creator gods established a line of hybrid god kings to rule these new civilizations. Human-looking kings that would serve as proxies so their reptilian masters could manage the general population in secret from the shadows. Manly P. Hall, 33rd degree Freemason and author of The Secret Teachings of All Ages, observed, "Egypt, a great center of learning and the birthplace of many arts and sciences, furnished an ideal environment for transcendental experimentation. Here the black magicians of Atlantis continued to exercise their superhuman powers until they had completely undermined and corrupted the morals of the primitive mysteries. These ancient mysteries held the secret to Anunnaki superscience, an example of which may be revealed in accounts of the Babylonian tablets of destiny possessed by Marduk, god of Babylon, who is depicted wearing such objects around his neck and on his breast. His heavily designed overcoat and headdress shows the motifs on the tablets. Sigils are symbols which contain great power and importance. The Egyptians, in their mythology, referred to a similar tablet of great wisdom and power. This was known as the Book of Thoth, written by the Egyptian god of wisdom, and as the text states, Thoth wrote the book with his own hand, and in it is all the magic in the world. If thou readest the first page, thou wilt enchant the sky, the earth, the abyss, the mountains, and the sea. Thou wilt understand the language of the birds of the air, and thou wilt know what the creeping things of the earth are saying, and thou wilt see the fishes from the darkest depths of the sea. If thou readest the other page, even though thou wert dead and in the world of ghosts, thou couldst come back to earth in the form thou once hadst. And besides this, thou wilt see the sun shining in the sky, with the full moon and the stars, and thou wilt behold the great shapes of the gods." These hermetic teachings of Thoth offered but a glance of the arcane powers of magic that the Anunnaki possessed, an occult or hidden knowledge that over the ensuing centuries would be the driving force to achieve the ultimate resurrection of the lost super technologies of Atlantis. Perhaps the most basic fundamental concept of ancient hermetic science was the understanding and manipulation of ether, the knowledge that an invisible energy permeates the entire universe. Like an incredible liquid medium, all the celestial worlds share their existence in this vast ocean of ether. As well, the ancients understood that much like stones dropped into a pond, concentric rings of energy radiated from stars and planets that produced a great symphony of energetic variations that could resonate with human consciousness and even influence human activities. Ancient priesthoods and magicians fully understood how this etheric energy combined astronomy, astrology, and alchemy into a single unified science. As well, they knew how this etheric energy could be manipulated by the use of symbols, sounds, and specific rituals. A particular technique for manipulation of this etheric field was known as the Kabbalah. At the beginning of the 6th century BC, a great portion of the Jewish population was conquered and exiled into Babylon by King Nebuchadnezzar, where they would remain for nearly half a century. During this exile, a faction of the Jews adopted the Babylonian system of magic and sorcery. These Jewish heretics rejected the God of the Old Testament because he forbade the practice of ritual magic, and instead they embraced the forbidden knowledge of Babylonian mysticism. In Babylon, these heretical Jews who refused to purge their religion of pagan influences, incorporated into their Talmudic traditions the adopted practices of Babylonian magic. Yet embedded within this magic were fragments of the secret alchemical science that survived the demise of the high civilizations that had vanished thousands of years earlier. A systematized version of this Babylonian magic, later transcribed by Hebrew priests, came to be known as the Kabbalah. Over ensuing centuries of Jewish migration, these occult Kabbalistic teachings would eventually spread into Spain and Eastern Europe. The Kabbalah itself was just a few pages long, but it contained descriptions of a spherical earth, parallel universes, and the atomic nature of matter, ideas that would become common doctrine amongst modern physicists and astronomers. The Hebrew Kabbalah is written in code. Codes are used to conceal multi-layered, complex information, which would later be studied by medieval alchemists. Sir Isaac Newton and many leading scientists studied the rich occult sciences within the Kabbalah. There was a time when mysticism, religion, alchemy, astronomy, and astrology were studied as one Kabbalistically based tradition. Modern-day quantum physics, chaos theory, and the notion of parallel universes can all be traced back to the original texts of the ancient Kabbalah. The Hebrew Kabbalah's highest black magic secret is that physical matter can be transformed molecule by molecule by the use of incantations of ancient Hebrew letters and numbers, and that the nature of reality is really an illusion. So-called advances in modern science are little more than the rediscovery of occult sciences lost to humanity many centuries ago. The ancient fundamentals of etheric manipulation were fully described by the famed inventor from Croatia, Nikola Tesla, as recent as 1908. Every ponderable atom is differentiated from a tenuous fluid filling all space merely by spinning motion, as a whirl of water in a calm lake. By being set in motion, this fluid, the ether, becomes gross matter. Its movement arrested, the primary substance reverts to its normal state, stillness. It appears then possible for a man, through harnessed energy of the medium and suitable agencies for starting and stopping ether whirls, to cause matter to form and disappear. At his command, almost without effort on his part, old worlds would vanish and new ones spring into being. He could alter the size of this planet, control its seasons, adjust its distance from the sun, guide it on its eternal journey along any path he might choose through the depths of the universe. He could make planets collide and produce his own suns and stars, his heat and light. He could originate life in all its infinite forms. To cause at will the birth and death of matter would be man's grandest deed, which would make him the master of physical creation, make him fulfill his ultimate destiny. Returning now to the research of Michael Tessarian, the fierce galactic war that raged in our solar system some 50,000 years ago reduced a major planet beyond Mars into fragments and forced the renegade Anunnaki to seek refuge on planet Earth. However, before departing our solar system, the enemies of the Anunnaki cautiously placed an energy grid around the Earth to keep them quarantined here forever. About the time of the 15th century, as they were congratulating themselves on their progress, the hidden brotherhood of Anunnaki descendants detected the presence of this quarantine barrier. They found themselves facing the hard reality that even if all their lost technology was successfully reconstructed, they still could not escape planet Earth. Their whole agenda, reaching back to the rise of Sumer and Babylon, had been to hurry mankind forward, to subjugate the Earth, to mine ores, to recreate their lost technological hardware, and yet even with all their super technology restored, they would still be trapped by the quarantine barrier. Undaunted by this discovery, the Anunnaki progeny decided to press ahead. Thus we see at the same time the spectacular surge in art and scientific thought across Europe that became known as the Renaissance. The world's greatest intellectual minds would be assembled to grapple with this problem, to see if a solution could be worked out, believing that anything technology could erect, technology could also take down. If you look at history properly from just this single agenda, the exponential rise of scientific intellect for the last 11,000 years has been to raise a new technology that will enable the surviving generations of the Dark Brotherhood to ultimately escape this planetary quarantine. And out of the 16th century arose the most powerful monarchy that enjoyed direct descent from the Anunnaki bloodline, the Tudor dynasty of England. The word Tudor comes from the word tutor, which means teacher, the educated ones with knowledge. The leader of the Tudor dynasty during this period was Elizabeth I, the Virgin Queen, who wore reptilian motifs on her gowns. And it was under her reign that the problem of the quarantine was secretly undertaken. The person who Elizabeth placed in charge of this research was her court astrologer, Sir John Dee. Dee was the founder of Enochian magic, an occult practice by which one can talk to the secret chiefs beyond our world. John Dee originally formed the British Secret Service, and his personal code was 007. The royal political elite, such as Emperor Rudolf of Prague and Elizabeth I, employed John Dee to summon the spirits, discarnate entities who, according to John Dee himself, recommended formation of a new world order, where the armies and navies of Great Britain would be sent out to conquer the Americas, India, Southeast Asia, and Austroasia. Dee composed a manifesto for world domination, which became the single goal of the occult elite, to enslave the world into a psychic dictatorship and to create a single world government ruled from Great Britain using black magic. Sir John Dee, one of history's most powerful black magicians, determined that the only way to solve the quarantine problem would be to consult his occult Enochian masters. By using his complex devices of magic and divination and the psychic visions of Edward Kelly, he succeeded in gaining the assistance of fourth dimensional entities or oversouls. This was not the first time in history such a forbidden rite was undertaken. Such ritual magic foreshadows the severest repercussions on human history. Dee knew that assistance from his Enochian overlords came at a high price, and that price was blood. Blood is spiritual currency. Blood constitutes life force energy. Thus, John Dee literally offered up the entire human race as a blood exchange in this great black mass. So desperate was the alien intent to escape Earth quarantine. And for centuries to come, great wars would provide Dee's demons with virtually unlimited blood payment. To attain a serious end, it behooves not to stop at any means or count the victims sacrificed for the sake of that end. The vast channeled information Dee received explained that there were two fundamental technologies which needed to be mastered before an escape portal could be opened. The first concerned creating matter from energy, revealed in two main stages: the release of energy from matter, followed by the creation of matter from energy. A second fundamental concerned unlocking the properties of the element silicon. Dee realized it would take hundreds of years before human intellect and industry could rise to accomplish these feats. So to launch this Herculean effort, an efficient means of focusing genius intellects and gathering knowledge was required. A Manhattan Project style of centralized effort would be needed to manage an operation of such scale. So along with his hidden masters, Dee devised a scheme to bring scholars to one place to study and amass the required knowledge. The gathering places for great intellects would become known as universities. Contemporary with John Dee in the Elizabethan court was Rosicrucian Sir Francis Bacon, who, like Dee, called for a general and universal reformation of the entire world, a renewal of all arts and sciences. Bacon's book, The New Atlantis, published after his death, described a utopia and a secret brotherhood signified by the Rose Cross, a call to all men of knowledge that united they might perfect a new method of all arts and sciences. Sir Francis Bacon was a passionate proponent of Britain's colonization and development of its recently acquired North American territory of Virginia. In 1606, the so-called Virginia Company was granted a royal charter by King James I, which allowed virtually unlimited power of government in the colony. Bacon had been instrumental in the creation of this charter. Bearing this in mind, it is not surprising that, in his novel, The New Atlantis, Bacon referred to his mythical island, Bensalem, as the Virgin of the World, a fitting analogy to the unspoiled world awaiting in North America. Queen Elizabeth's Tudor dynasty was served by the pirates, or the Pirates, men of fire, headed by adventurers like Sir Francis Drake and Edmund Spenser, leaders of British imperialism. The progeny of these enterprising pirates settled on the lands they conquered and opened great universities for the education of their sons and daughters. They employed the fraternity structure to ensure that only the chosen would be exposed to the real occult history of the world and to be groomed as the future leaders and thinkers. Overworld and underworld figures, educated and funded, to skillfully lead the rest of mankind down whatever roads became necessary. How do we account for a unified occult operation stretching over millennia that somehow renders countless generations of human individuals to function almost as a single organism focused to complete a single task? Such a plan seems unthinkable from the minuscule perspective of a fleetingly brief human lifetime. It would seem that such a vast working could only be managed by some superhuman intellect that exists outside of time and space. Many occult traditions which are related to the birth of Freemasonry speak of the hidden masters. Some occult historians and authors claim that just such a group of hidden masters control international Freemasonry. Ancient Masonic texts suggest these hidden masters are in fact alien entities from another world. Some Masonic texts state that the secret to control and influence society and politics behind the scenes was passed to the highest initiates of Freemasonry from a race of reptilian aliens who invaded planet Earth and landed in ancient Iraq. For thousands of years, knowledge of these so-called Anunnaki aliens has been the most important secret of the royal political elite. The 17th and 18th centuries saw the intricate expansion of secret fraternity networks throughout Britain and Europe. Occult societies that revered the esoteric knowledge originally expressed in the craft of stone masonry from ancient Egyptian traditions. Sacred geometry, which comprised the core teaching of any genuine mystery school of antiquity, was incorporated into the design of buildings that enabled them to function as resonant cavities, which were attuned to the dynamic energies that pervade the cosmos. In cities around the world, many famous buildings use sacred geometry designed to create and magnify specific resonances in the etheric field, just like the temples of ancient Egypt. The colonization of the New World encouraged the grandest ambitions of the hidden brotherhoods to advance the Anunnaki agenda. Contrary to popular understanding, the United States was not founded on the ideals of freedom and democracy. The United States was founded as an occult Freemason enterprise. The Freemasons needed a base for criminal activities. American Freemasonry was used in the 18th century to protect organized crime, including opium smuggling, piracy, and later illegal slave trading, and to deceive the public and rewrite history. George Washington tried to restrict the rising influence of the aggressive Bavarian Illuminati, but without success. All Freemason presidents who succeeded him were Illuminati. One of the real causes of the American Civil War was that Freemasons, under Confederate General Albert Pike, tried to establish the world's greatest slave realm, including Cuba and Mexico, calling it the American Confederation, with its capital in Richmond, Virginia. And although the various lodges acted to bring this about, election of non-Freemason and Republican Abraham Lincoln derailed this ambition. Lincoln was voted into office in November 1860 to the great dismay of the Freemasons. Shortly after assuming the presidency in 1861, he was the target of an unsuccessful assassination attempt in Baltimore, Maryland. So Masonic Grand Master Albert Pike then chose another solution, the Civil War, which started on April 12, 1861. A conflict that would serve the Anunnaki agenda of transforming America from an agricultural society into an industrial society. And the rise of the industrial age would serve a twofold purpose that would both advance technology exponentially and create wars for limitless blood sacrifice. The conspiratorial nature of Freemasonry was explicitly defined by Albert Pike in his Masonic Lexicon book, Morals and Dogma. Masonry, like all the religions, all the mysteries, hermeticism, and alchemy, conceals its secrets from all except the adepts and sages, or the elect, and uses false explanations and misinterpretations of its symbols to mislead those who deserve only to be misled, to conceal the truth which it calls light from them, and to draw them away from it. Truth is not for those who are unworthy, are unable to receive it, or would pervert it. The truth must be kept secret, and the masses need a teaching proportioned to their imperfect reason. Giuseppe Mazzini of Italy, founder of the Mafia, was a 33rd degree Freemason who replaced Adam Weishaupt as head of the Bavarian Illuminati in 1834. Mazzini appointed America's Albert Pike as sovereign pontiff of universal Freemasonry and the coordinator of the Illuminati United States activities. Pike was a Tennessee Ku Klux Klan judicial officer. A known Satanist, Pike indulged in phallic worship and the occult. He wore a satanic Baphomet symbol around his neck and used his bracelet to summon Lucifer. Yet despite his conviction for treason, Pike's body lies heroically enshrined in Washington, D.C.'s Scottish Rite Freemason Temple. With the decline of virtue, which has preceded the destruction of every nation of history, the mysteries became perverted. Sorcery took the place of divine magic. Indescribable practices were introduced, and perversion ruled supreme. For no institution can be any better than the members of which it is composed. In a letter to Mazzini dated August 15, 1871, Albert Pike graphically outlined a blueprint for three planned world wars. World War I would weaken, topple, and destroy the powerful Tsarist government in Russia. World War II would pit Great Britain against Germany, destroy Nazism, and create the Zionist state of Israel. And World War III would be ignited by fueling aggression between the Zionist state of Israel and the Arab world, who would eventually destroy one another. But in fact, these great wars masked the age-old Anunnaki plan to finally raise humanity's capacity for warfare and ritual blood sacrifice to an industrial scale. By the 20th century, the great work of Elizabethan alchemist Sir John Dee's Black Magic Blueprint had been successfully realized, spawning vast global conflicts and virtually limitless technological advancement, bringing the occult Anunnaki elite one step closer to their goal of quarantine liberation. After four centuries of slow but relentless progress, human technologies had reached the level required by Dee's Enochian masters to transform energy out of matter. Advanced weapons science spawned by both American and German physicists during World War II had actually accomplished the alchemical quest to unleash the power of the atom, a feat ultimately accomplished with the Trinity atomic bomb test. A group of American scientists, led by Dr. J. Robert Oppenheimer, gathered in a remote area of New Mexico known as Jornada del Muerto, or Journey of Death. There at 5:29 a.m. on July 16, 1945, the United States military detonated America's first atomic bomb. The ancient Brahma weapons, described in the Mahabharata, were restored, and appropriately, Dr. Oppenheimer, the atomic bomb's designer, uttered the Vedic invocation. Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds. And following in August, the Japanese cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki were destroyed by atomic bombs. But beyond atom bomb technology, a practical application of Tesla's torsion theory may have been advanced as well by the Third Reich during World War II with their mysterious, top-secret Diglaka or Bell project at the Risa complex in Poland. This strange cylinder device generated a tremendous vortex in the etheric field by counter-rotating mercury plasma. Though many speculate it was merely an anti-gravity flying device, it seems more likely to have been a primitive attempt to create an artificial wormhole portal that could pierce the quarantine barrier. Whatever its use, the Bell Project and its designers vanished just before the war's end, and yet speculation remains that the Nazis had brought the plasma cosmology of the stars and even the galaxies themselves down to a device as small as a camping trailer, and they were using it to manipulate directly the fabric of the physical medium of space-time itself. Even today, manipulating space and time is speculated to be the true purpose of the multi-billion dollar CERN Large Hadron Collider located near Geneva, Switzerland. This particle accelerator may generate a wormhole escape portal on an even grander scale than the Nazi Bell. A telltale sculpture stands in the CERN facility courtyard, a huge image of the Hindu god Shiva, prancing in the center of a symbolic stargate. But the Bell Project was likely the result of deeper arcane research gained by the Nazi Annenerbe Society, the most mysterious organization within Hitler's Third Reich. This society was the only known historical structure engaged in the study of the occult and mysticism to have state funding and support. No organization in the world had at its disposal such a volume of data or had such influence on the development of occult technology as the Annenerbe Society. Nazi ideology was based on the theory that in the ancient past there existed a powerful Earth civilization with access to the secrets of the universe. Somewhere encrypted and scattered, this higher knowledge was preserved. Specifically, they were tasked with reviving the superhuman in Germany and their role as ancient Aryan descendants. They were profoundly interested in Atlantis, which their scientists believed to be the native home of the Aryan race. Ultima Thule was the Teutonic name for the mythical capital from which the occult Thule Society took its name. Therefore, the Nazis saw the German people as the rightful heir to legendary Atlantean technological knowledge. Just prior to the war's start, Annenerbe secret expeditions began searching for ancient relics and manuscripts around the world, from Tibet to South America. Notably, they hunted for the Knights Templar archives, which may have contained secrets about Atlantean artifacts hidden in North America and even the Antarctic. Of course, after the end of the war, much of this occult knowledge, as well as the Nazi scientists and administrators who possessed it, were quietly absorbed into the American Space Program, NASA, and the Central Intelligence Agency via Operation Paperclip. Astrologer Wilhelm Wolff, in 1939, described the ultimate goal of Annenerbe research was to harness not only natural, but also supernatural forces. All intellectual, natural, and supernatural sources of power, from modern technology to medieval black magic, and from the teachings of Pythagoras to the Faustian pentagram incantation, were to be exploited for the interests of final victory. It's been more than half a century since the Second World War, but technological and scientific advancement continues to plunge towards some unfathomable destiny with ever-accelerating speed. Technological skills that once took centuries to master have been conquered in decades, and technologies that once took decades to master now only take months. 17th century alchemist John Dee was told by his hidden masters that the key to expanding human intellect would be discovered in the element silicon, from which the computer microchip was eventually spawned. Although 21st century computer science seems superficially to be a great boon to modern society, it is in fact a diabolical Trojan horse intended to monitor and manipulate the collective population. Colonel Philip Corso, former National Security Advisor to President Eisenhower, speculating about the microchip components recovered in 1947 from a crashed UFO near Roswell, New Mexico, stated, "Computers themselves almost became something like a silicon-based life form, inspiring the carbon-based life forms on planet Earth to develop them, grow them, and even help them reproduce." Maybe the Roswell crash was also the mechanism for successfully implanting a completely alien, non-human life form that survives from host to host, like a virus, a digital Ebola, that we humans will carry to another planet someday? Or what if an enemy wanted to implant the perfect spying or sabotage mechanism into a culture? Then the implantation of the microchip-based culture into our technology by the EBs would be the perfect weapon. Could it not be argued that the silicone wafers we recovered from Roswell were the real masters and space travelers, and the EB creatures their hosts and servants? We are now in the midst of a technological revolution promising to re-engineer our species into immortals, a nexus point called the singularity, a time when artificial intelligence will replace humans as the dominant species of our planet. But is this wondrous program of biological modification actually the latest Anunnaki plan to introduce a cyborg upgrade of their human slave race? In December of 2001, the National Science Foundation and the Department of Commerce organized a workshop to review the impending arrival of what Freemason Newt Gingrich called the Age of Transitions. Concepts discussed at this workshop were published in a report, Converging Technologies for Improving Human Performance, Nanotechnology, Biotechnology, Information Technology, and Cognitive Science. The idea behind this workshop was to set an agenda for the future, the key goal, enhancing human performance, merging human biology with technology, that would lead to a more efficient societal structure. In other words, creating the optimum slave race by eliminating the last vestiges of human free will altogether. Inevitably, the cybernetic enhancement of human performance is sneaking up on society. So once more, let us reconsider Michael Tsarian's assertion that 50,000 years ago, planet Earth was invaded and conquered by alien marauders marooned here in a galactic war. And since that time, these invaders have enslaved the human population and plundered the resources of the planet in a desperate attempt to fully restore their lost weapons and spaceflight technologies, a centuries-long process finally reaching completion. Yet surely we must consider that despite the vast expanse of time that has elapsed since that war, the extraterrestrial opponents of these Anunnaki have likely not forgotten their enemies. And further, we must consider that as recent as 1945, the Earthbound Anunnaki warlords announced to the universe through the light-speed signature of atomic detonations that they have not abandoned their warlike ways. So what kind of response might the restoration of full Anunnaki military power provoke? Has the proliferation of space-based weapons defense since the Reagan administration really been Star Wars protection from global political squabbles? Or have the Anunnaki masters fully anticipated renewal of a major galactic war? And have they been secretly buttressing their weapons arsenal to meet an inevitable Tower of Babel moment, to prevent being blasted once more into the Stone Age. Very likely a great space armada blockade, even now, is poised in our solar system to confront any attempted Anunnaki breakout. So what becomes of Earth humans? A species that for all its recorded history has never known freedom. A species with amnesia, that has no true understanding of its actual history. A species that has been exploited and plundered no less than the very planet it inhabits. If humans should survive a renewed galactic war, and should the Anunnaki ultimately be defeated, what becomes of their genetically engineered progeny? Could Earth humans be rehabilitated? As hybrids, they still carry Anunnaki DNA, the potential to be equally as clever and aggressive as their creators. Would there be any future for contemporary Earth humans at all? Michael Tesarian summarizes his Atlantis research like this. The Serpent Masters who visited our planet ages ago arrived and took over without permission. They literally invaded our sovereign planet and interfered with the destiny and evolution of the native inhabitants, while possessing no legal status, so to speak. Like many terrestrial illegal immigrants, these aliens had, and their progeny have, no love for the world they occupy. Their treatment of the Earth tells us as much. Their plundering of nations, their decimation of indigenous peoples, and their violation of nature should be taken as ample evidence of their origin. The human victims of the Earth must therefore remedy the injustices perpetrated against them by assertively taking back their power and exercising their birthright as Earth citizens. Men and women have the right to bring justice and even expunge those who have violated the universal laws and human sovereignty, and who themselves have no status or jurisdiction or authority. The so-called controllers, or hidden masters, the secret chiefs, those descendants of the original alien visitors whose influence and machinations have wrought untold horrors on the Earth, have absolutely no legal right to hold their offices, to pass their laws, to exercise command, or to foment wars to slaughter, impoverish, enslave, divide, and mislead mankind. They have no right to interfere in any way with the destiny and evolution of the Earth. Since they have appropriated these rights, they must be held totally accountable for every one of their machinations and crimes. The Anunnaki have not, as some scholars assert, left this planet in the days of old. Therefore, they are not about to return to save us from ourselves. They have never been away. And it is they who have brought the conditions that plague us. To work for their continuing exposure and final elimination continues. Of ether. As well, the ancients understood that much like stones dropped into a pond, concentric rings of energy radiated from stars and planets that produced a great symphony of energetic variations that could resonate with human consciousness and even influence human activities. Ancient priesthoods and magicians fully understood how this etheric energy combined astronomy, astrology, and alchemy into a single unified science. As well, they knew how this etheric energy could be manipulated by the use of symbols, sounds, and specific rituals. A particular technique for manipulation of this etheric field was known as the Kabbalah. At the beginning of the 6th century BC, a great portion of the Jewish population was conquered and exiled into Babylon by King Nebuchadnezzar, where they would remain for nearly half a century. During this exile, a faction of the Jews adopted the Babylonian system of magic and sorcery. These Jewish heretics rejected the God of the Old Testament because he forbade the practice of ritual magic, and instead they embraced the forbidden knowledge of Babylonian mysticism. In Babylon, these heretical Jews, who refused to purge their religion of pagan influences, incorporated into their Talmudic traditions the adopted practices of Babylonian magic. Yet embedded within this magic were fragments of the secret alchemical science that survived the demise of the high civilizations that had vanished thousands of years earlier. A systematized version of this Babylonian magic, later transcribed by Hebrew priests, came to be known as the Kabbalah. Over ensuing centuries of Jewish migration, these accused by Marduk, god of Babylon, who is depicted wearing such objects around his neck and on his breast. His heavily designed overcoat and headdress shows the motifs on the tablets. Sigils are symbols which contain great power and importance. The Egyptians, in their mythology, referred to a similar tablet of great wisdom and power. This was known as the Book of Thoth, written by the Egyptian god of wisdom, and as the text states, Thoth wrote the book with his own hand, and in it is all the magic in the world. If thou readest the first page, thou wilt enchant the sky, the earth, the abyss, the mountains, and the sea. Thou wilt understand the language of the birds of the air, and thou wilt know what the creeping things of the earth are saying, and thou wilt see the fishes from the darkest depths of the sea. If thou readest the other page, even though thou wert dead and in the world of ghosts, thou couldst come back to earth in the form thou once hadst. And besides this, thou wilt see the sun shining in the sky, with the full moon and the stars, and thou wilt behold the great shapes of the gods. These hermetic teachings of Thoth offered but a glance of the arcane powers of magic that the Anunnaki possessed, an occult or hidden knowledge that over the ensuing centuries would be the driving force to achieve the ultimate resurrection of the lost super technologies of Atlantis. Perhaps the most basic fundamental concept of ancient Hermetic science was the understanding and manipulation of ether, the knowledge that an invisible energy permeates the entire universe. Like an incredible liquid medium, all the celestial worlds share their existence in this vast ocean. In other words, technologies at least comparable to what modern civilization has virtually duplicated here in the early years of the 21st century. Tessarian's account describes the Anunnaki as a highly aggressive reptilian humanoid race that genetically engineered a slave race out of the indigenous humanoid creatures of Earth. These hybrids became known as the Elohim. However, possessing the high intelligence from their portion of Anunnaki DNA, these Elohim eventually rejected their slave status and established an independent culture of their own in an uneasy truce. But eventually a conflict erupted between these cultures that escalated into a devastating thermonuclear war that laid virtually the entire planet to waste. The epic poem of Vedic antiquity, called the Mahabharata, describes these wars telling of deadly Brahma weapons that decimated whole armies with a flash of fire as bright as 1,000 suns, leaving survivors to die days later of a horrible sickness, an uncanny likeness to the effects of modern atomic radiation poisoning. The myth of the lost continent of Atlantis is but a fragmentary description of this great war. According to Greek philosopher Plato's account, in a single day and night of misfortune, the island of Atlantis disappeared into the depths of the sea. A civilization possessing weapons of mass destruction at least equal to or even surpassing technologies we know today was utterly destroyed. The long march of human history, recorded since that mighty catastrophe, marks the slow restoration of those long-lost alien sciences. Dr. Joseph P. Farrell, author of The Cosmic War, states, "There was once a very high paleo-ancient civilization long ago with science and technology far beyond our own. That civilization was interplanetary by extent. It existed in our own celestial neighborhood. It fought a war and blew itself apart, and as it was doing so, realizing that it would lose all of its high science, it initiated efforts to preserve it. The rise of the mystery schools, ancient religions, occult societies, and all such groups since then have been a long-term recovery process, and the people involved have been doing so covertly. Recorded history, starting with the rise of sophisticated civilizations in Mesopotamia some 6,000 years ago, marks the beginning of the Anunnaki return to power, and the epic process of restoring the full extent of their magical sciences. To accomplish this goal, these creator gods established a line of hybrid god kings to rule these new civilizations, human-looking kings that would serve as proxies so their reptilian masters could manage the general population in secret from the shadows." Manly P. Hall, 33rd degree Freemason and author of The Secret Teachings of All Ages, observed, "Egypt, a great center of learning and the birthplace of many arts and sciences, furnished an ideal environment for transcendental experimentation. Here the black magicians of Atlantis continued to exercise their superhuman powers until they had completely undermined and corrupted the morals of the primitive mysteries. These ancient mysteries held the secret to Anunnaki superscience, an example of which may be revealed in accounts of the Babylonian tablets of destiny possessed." According to ancient Sumerian legend, a race of technologically advanced extraterrestrials colonized Earth some 6,000 years ago and helped establish sophisticated civilizations in Mesopotamia. The great empires of Sumer, Babylon, Assyria, and even Egypt were the direct result of this interaction with the Anunnaki, the gods who came down from the skies. This ancient aliens account has been popularized by the scholarly research of Zechariah Sitchin in his book, The Twelfth Planet. However, noted Celtic researcher Michael Tessarian suggests that although Sitchin's translations from Sumerian cuneiform are accurate, he speculates that the Sumerians themselves may have deliberately altered this story. His alternative view suggests that a great galactic war may have forced the Anunnaki to seek refuge on our little planet many thousands of years earlier than the Sumerian account implies. And as well, Tessarian claims that the great mythological empires of Atlantis and Lemuria were actually the original Anunnaki colonies. It is believed that these space invaders possessed amazing supernatural technologies described as genetic engineering, mind control, weather manipulation, interstellar spaceflight, nuclear weapons, and even the capacity to destroy celestial bodies.